So I was talking to a friend of mine, and guy who's single, he's been on all these dating apps and matrimonial apps and whatnot, and hasn't had a lot of luck. And he said, "Hey, you'd written a blog post about women want this and women want that and these are that, but you never really went into details of anything. So what are women actually looking for?" And before I could say anything to him, he was like, "Yeah, I was reading this book called The Game." I was like, "Wait a minute, like, I don't know if you've heard of this." Yeah, you
I
have, right?
have.
Yeah. So I feel like and then I started like sort of researching relationship coaches or dating coaches in India, and I saw that there was this whole world of like pickup artists and things like that, but like I couldn't see a woman's perspective on this, right? Like normal women's perspective on this, where there isn't sort of like some shady advice saying, "Hey, if a woman is dancing like 5 feet from you, that means she wants to sleep with you tonight," kind of advice.
All the advice we give each other as women is like, call me, carry pepper spray, try not to die. God.
I was like, okay, I would like to actually break this whole journey down and try and get a real woman's perspective on what is it that women want. I know that, you're not going to be answering for all the women out there and people asking for
Hashtag not all women.
exactly, right? So guys, that's a caveat, okay? So take this with a pinch of salt, but like I'm guessing you can apply this to women who are like you or like me, largely like us. I wanted to start right at the beginning, and I wanted to first explore a physical scenario. Like obviously that's not happening now because of COVID and stuff, and it doesn't happen very often. But when you are in a physical setting, what's a good way for somebody to get your attention without approaching you, like before they approach you? Like what do you look at and then think, "Hey, that's, this is somebody I can chat with if he comes up to me, or like I could go up to him and talk to him." Like what are the cues?
So for me, taller than me, obviously, which
Okay.
automatically slashes the population down to
Right.
like two people.
Right.
Well dressed. I mean, like if we are, I'm assuming this is at a nightclub type of
Right.
situation, or
Right.
like even a house party, whatever.
Right. Right.
Well dressed is a big one for me, not because I'm shallow, but like I feel like you should want to present yourself well, you know,
Sure.
and care about how you come across. So that's one.
What is well dressed? What does well dressed mean?
Like dressing for the occasion, for example, like if we're at a house party, then like yeah, like jeans and a t-shirt is fine, but I would hope that you're not gonna come in like gym shorts and a banyan, you know, like
Right,
or gym shorts and a t-shirt and like rubber chappals from the house. If we're out at like a bar or whatever, that you're wearing, you know, like a stylish t-shirt, like you know, one of those nice ones. With like jeans that fit you well. It just has to fit you well. Like it doesn't have to be Gucci, Armani, Prada, whatever. It needs to fit you correctly, not be like falling off you. And like if you're wearing shoes, then not like sports shoes, like actual going out shoes, you know, like those semi-formal ones, whatever. Socks. Please wear socks. You know, that kind of thing.
I feel like, you might think that this is so basic, but there are so many people out there who like have no clue about this, right? And I feel like this is such great gyan, especially for men who literally got no access to real women, and everything that they've learned about women is from like movies or pornography and things like that. So
Yeah.
this is,
Also, public service announcement, men, there is a difference between athletic socks and dress socks. So if you're wearing Oxford or like, you know, those fancy shoes, you need to be in dress socks, which is a different thing. You can get them in funky patterns, but please don't wear your Nike Reebok workout socks with your nice shoes. If you can match your belt and shoe, even more props. But yeah. Also, just sort of generally well groomed, you know, like decent haircut, and like if you have a beard, like it's sort of maintained. That kind of, I mean, that's the kind of person that I go for. I know there are people who really like the grizzly sort of or natural, rugged vibe. Not for me. I went through that phase, but I think I'm done with that now. So yeah, just like sort of well-dressed, well-groomed, in shape, ideally, because, I mean, I'm not a bodybuilder or anything, but like I like working out and sort of taking care of my fitness and stuff. So I would appreciate that. Slash, to be really shallow, I'm all about the ripped abs kind of situation. But that's just, you know, personal preference. That's just sort of the physical things that I look for.
Sure.
It's also a green flag if they are with a group and there are women in that group. And it's not just kind of like him alone at the bar, because those, like, you know, those kind of sketchy guys who are just by themselves at the bar, like, you know that they're there to like pick up chicks. Like, I don't want somebody who's there to pick up chicks. Like, if you have a group of friends and you're with them and there are females there, then that's sort of like a little bit of a green tick for me, because, okay, you have female friends and they're not creeped out by you, so you might be a decent person.
Right.
So that's another.
What about if you're an introvert? I mean, what about if you're an introvert and, like, you know, groups just like, or that, you know, you're at a party where, like, let's say you don't really actually know too many people, but you've been invited by, like, you know, the host or something like that. How about that? Like, if they're alone, what would you like them to sort of be doing for you to find them attractive and not creepy?
That's an interesting question. If they don't know anyone else there, like if they're alone, I mean, I would expect them to maybe like sort of make some conversation. Like, you know, if I'm going to the fridge to get ice or something, they can just come up and be like, hey, can I have some too? And then start the conversation from there.
Got it.
Just like make it smooth, you know, like not just like, hi, are you alone? I do. I'm alone. Like, not like that. So just if it's a physical requirement. And then, so also I like the non-aggressive kind of thing where like, if we've made eye contact like two or three times, then you know that like you're checking them out, but they're also checking you out, and then they caught you checking them out, and you caught them checking you out, the whole thing. And then like I am very forthcoming in the sense that I will smile. And if they smile back, then I'm like open to like having them come over or whatever. But if they're just like, I mean, I appreciate that you're stunned by my beauty and all, but that's not gonna work. So I just want to play smooth. Also, this is a great situation to like pull a wingman type of thing, right? Like, tell the host, like, dude, who is this girl? Like, give me an introduction, and then the host can slyly just sort of bring them over and be like, hey, Rishi, this is so and so. He's been in town. I think you guys will get along. Bye. Because I've had friends do this. Like, they've literally walked me up to a table with this really beautiful man and just been like, Urvashi, so-and-so, so-and-so, Urvashi, bye. And then me and so-and-so were just like,
yeah, that was awkward.
But in a way, that was enough. But in a way, that was enough. It was somebody to bridge the gap.
Sure, that makes sense. Okay, so now, like, they're coming up to you. What would be like an interesting conversation starter?
Something contextual, like depending on where we are.
Excuse me, is this your kerchief?
Yeah, please. First of all, I don't carry a kerchief. Excuse me, madam, your bra strap is showing. Oh, I'm slapped. How to get rejected? So I was saying something contextual, like if we're at a house party, you know, maybe just walk up and be like, hey, so how do you know so-and-so? Or like, hey, sorry, you know, I'm just trying to get the beer. Like, I don't really know anyone else here or whatever. That's also fine.
Yeah.
Definitely not a pickup line.
Right.
Like a generic compliment is fine. Like, hey, I really like your shoes, or like, you know, I really like your hair or whatever, something random, right? Not like, you light up the night or some bullshit. Like, do you like bananas because I'm a Kayla? Don't work. That being said, though, I have used the Akela line on somebody once and it did work, but I think that's because I'm not a man, and so there's no fear that I will murder them.
Right.
So definitely not a pickup line.
Once they've started talking to you, like, what is something that keeps a conversation going? Is it them asking you questions about you, or will it feel to interview? Like, what makes for an interesting, like, conversation continuer?
Just like adding interesting and relevant anecdotes or questions. Mm-hmm. So yes, I do want them to also talk about themselves a little bit, otherwise it does feel too interviewing.
Right.
But just like, yeah, you know, if I'm talking about like, oh, you know, I went to Cubbon Park or whatever, and the other person could be like, yeah, I went there like last week and it was really pretty, whatever. So just keep the ball rolling a little bit. If there is a silence, like, I know there are some people who have this tendency to like laugh about the awkward silence. Like, don't do it. It's okay. You know, when you met for the first time, it's fine. There's going to be an awkward silence. Okay.
Interesting.
Take a sip of your drink, do whatever. We can come up with a... And I'm such a chatty person, dude. I will fill the silence in a matter of seconds.
Right.
I think that... I think there are lots of people who play this whole, like, haha, I'm so awkward game. Like, don't.
Okay. That's interesting. I somehow thought, like, that worked. It did. Like, it doesn't.
It might work on some people, but I am not a big fan of it. I'm just like, just want to do it. You spill something on yourself, whatever. All of us do it. Like, you know, if you just want to be like, oh, whoops, and clean it up, it's fine. But don't like drag it on and be like, oh, I'm such a klutz. Like, just go on about it. Like,
that's
we all drop things on ourselves.
That's it. So like that. Okay. How does somebody take the cue on, hey, this is actually a good conversation, I'd like to sort of talk to you again? Like, how can they figure out if they've done well with you, or like, you know, with a woman that they're chatting with, and I don't know, ask for your number or say or make a suggestion that you should catch up again or whatever? Like, because people are always afraid that they may not have actually made a good impression, but they also don't want to miss out on the chance of asking you your number and so on. Like, is there a way for people to figure out if this has been a good conversation?
So for me personally, I don't really like the can I get your number, but like if there's a way to do like to open up the offer but not really pursue it. Just, you know, you could drop something like, yeah, I'm going to go see this thing next week. Let me know if you'd like to, if that's something that you're into or whatever. Or say like, yeah, this was, you know, this was a really great conversation. I have this one specific follow-up question for you. Let me know when we can chat about it. So just like, offer it like, I'd like to talk to you more about this thing, and then just leave it. Like, if the person follows up and says, yeah, here's my number, my email address, whatever, that's fine.
Got it.
But I've had people who've gone straight for phone number, and I'm just like,
giving them the wrong
number. If you hadn't asked, maybe I would. I've never given a wrong number, I've just said no.
Okay,
I'm just like, no, you're not getting my number. That's it. You want to email me about work related things, you can.
Right. Okay. Got it. Makes sense. Okay. So, what actually results for you, like in the past, like based on your like past experience, have you had one conversation with somebody and then like taken them up on their offer to like meet up again or like, you know, chat or whatever? And how has that happened? Like, what did they say that made you want to talk to them again?
For example, if you sort of meet at like a house party and you know, then you sort of just joke about it and you're like, oh, I'll find you on Facebook, I'll find you on Instagram or whatever, and you leave it. And then you do follow up and find that person on Facebook and Instagram. You connect, you talk for a bit, and then you make it happen again. So like there's a way to do that without necessarily swapping numbers until the person is ready.
But isn't that creepy, like to suddenly like stalk you and be like, hey, I found you on Facebook or like Instagram? And
but if we've met in person and we've talked, to me, that's not creepy.
Okay. Cool.
Met, we've talked, we've connected. So
Yeah. Cool. And what I'm going to do is like, before I continue further, now I want to like bring the element of online, right? Like, because after this point, when you go on a date, like online, offline, same thing, right? Like, so if you are online, have you tried any of these dating apps?
All. Not the shadi ones. But I've tried like Bumble, Tinder,
Okay, so we'll start right at the beginning. Like, what kind of a profile gets your attention? Like, what kind of pictures? What kind of like a bio gets your attention?
There are some definite like, ugh, no way am I touching this with a 10-foot pole, and the others like, okay, could be considered. The red flags are like, you know, people who look like their profiles are fake. Like, you're just too beautiful and you're making the same face in every photo. Like, you have 5 photos and all the 5 photos are just like do you not have any emotion? That's one. And then the lazy profiles I really don't like, which is just like 2 photos and nothing else. Like, write a bio, bro. Like, at least fill in that stuff that they ask you. Like, where did you study? Whatever it might, these two are chatting with each other. So fill out the thing that it asks you to, right? The question prompts and everything. Right. Because if you're not going to put in that much effort to fill out your goddamn dating profile, then what effort are you going to take later? Dude? Like, there are some that are super sexual. Just like shirtless, chuddy showing, kind of just like looking for fun. I'm just like, and some are just like these awkward selfie photos, which
are, like all of them are just like software engineer invoices.
Like, software engineer definitely never takes a bad photo. I will say, kudos to like the 25-year-olds. Like, I set my age range to like 20 to 29 ones just out of curiosity. And my God, those boys have game. They have like woken up at 5 a.m. and gone to Nice Road and taken the photos, you know, like they have gone all out. They've got the outfit, the hair, the whole thing. So I feel like you should take some effort. So those are the definite, like, that this is not happening. Things that are like green flag-ish are like, okay, you've got like 3-4 pictures, you've answered all the points, and you've like made some interesting comment in your, you know, responses or in your bio.
What's an interesting comment? Like, give me examples of like, what are interesting things to say?
Like, if you're just, you know, upfront about how much you love Disney movies, or if you're like, you know, scary on the outside but scared of cockroaches on the inside, like just something real and genuine and funny.
How do you draw the line between, oh my God, this person's trying so hard, versus, hey, this is genuinely funny?
I think someone who puts in like one funny comment is funny, but someone who's like, and you know, there are these like tried and tested things which are like, oh, voted best looking by my mom, like, okay, just you know, there are these templates that I've seen on these profiles where someone like they'll all have the same format, you know, and some of them type the whole bloody CV, dude. Like, 10th class this much marks, 12th class this much marks, engineering $1,000
prize in potato race.
Relax. Yeah, exactly. So some of them like go too far out, and they have this whole thing of like, oh yeah. And then some of them, you can tell they're just like humble bragging, right? They're just like, oh yeah, living that chartered flight life. Like, I only drink Moe. Like, and they're just like standing outside this Armani store with like one bag. Like, bro, just relax. Just like be a real person. If you wear Armani, just shut up and wear it quietly. No need to tell everyone. So to me, that is like
a tattoo. Got it.
You know, this person is clearly compensating for a lack of personality. Like, seriously, is it that hard to take like 3 decent selfies of yourself?
Now, these are kind of profiles that are interesting for you. But like, once there is a match with somebody, like, what's the protocol? Like, what's an interesting sort of approach? Like, because one of the problems that I've seen is like there'll be too many boys who'll be like texting you saying, hey, hi, sweaty, and like things like that. So how do you like sort of find the interesting voice?
Like, usually I will open, if it's on Bumble, then a girl has to open a conversation. Yeah. So that's okay. But if the guy is opening, then something again contextual to my profile. So if I've said like, oh, you know, never have I ever been scuba diving or whatever, then I'd like them to come in and be like, oh, I really want to go scuba diving also, or just like message saying, I'm deadly afraid of deep water, I'm never going to go scuba diving, but if you want to go skydiving, I'm down. Like, you know, something like that.
So they should talk about something that you've sort of written about and stuff like that.
Yeah, something contextual.
How about the whole, hi, how are you? Because I find that there are like a lot of people who slide into DMs here on Insta and they'll say hi. Like, if you said more, maybe I would respond to you. But like,
yeah, I mean, but it seems to work really well for other people.
Oh, really?
I mean, yeah. So some people don't want something seemingly intrusive in terms of the opening, and they just want something chill. So that works for some people, I guess.
But tell me one thing, maybe like, I've never really like used these dating apps so much that I know how it works. Like, do you generally have a lot of like men in the DMs, or is it just a lot of men that you have to swipe through? Like, you also end up having a lot of matches. Is there a problem of too many matches sometimes?
For women, yes, there are in general across the board, because men have this habit of swiping right all
correct,
the time.
Correct, yeah.
So yes, that's definitely an issue. And I feel like, you know, for me, honestly, I think I've just been through the whole thing so many times. I can tell within like the first day of conversation whether I want to continue the conversation or not. Because some of them like literally don't ever ask you anything about yourself. Like, and then you can tell that they're talking to 20 other people. Because they're just sending one word responses like twice a day. Right. And it's like, okay, you're probably like logging on, replying to 17 people and moving on, which is fine. I am too. But like, at least pretend that, you care about this match. Right. So that does happen, but it's easy to weed out after that, I think. Like, however much you feel like you've filtered the profile.
Yeah.
And dude, I'm like, I hate to say this, but I'm a stickler for like spelling with full words, dude.
Oh, yeah.
You don't have to get the spelling perfect every time. But just, how are you? Yeah, just don't. HRU? Like, what are you doing with all that extra time you're saving?
Yeah, makes sense. Okay. So what gets somebody from like the DM of the app to WhatsApp, for instance? Like, when do you say, okay, you know, this was interesting and this needs to move to WhatsApp?
If it was truly effortless and actually fun. So like if you click with someone, right, and you are chatting with them easily, then that's good enough. Like, you shouldn't have to force yourself to be what that other person wants you to be if that's not who you are. Because if you are like an anime junkie who is vegan and has three cats, you will find someone who is an anime junkie who has three cats who is vegan. Like, you don't have to force fit yourself to me.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So that's one thing generally. Like, if we are clearly disagreeing on many things, like, and have conflicting opinions about many things, it's okay. Call it a day. Move on.
Right.
Don't try to force fit yourself into this. That's one thing I would say.
Right.
In terms of like trying really hard to make the conversation happen.
Right.
Usually the thing is like, if I have a similar background with somebody, like somebody lived abroad and then they came back or something like that. And we find one common topic and then we're able to keep that topic rolling. Like, we're able to keep finding similar things. So let's say we start talking about scuba diving, then it goes to skydiving, then it goes to, you know, amusement parks, then it goes to, which was the last one you went to? Then it goes to, have you ever eaten this thing? Like, the conversation just keeps rolling. Not necessarily because that person is interrogating you, but because you're sharing an anecdote, they're sharing an anecdote, you're asking a question, they're asking a question. And the responses are like funny and interesting and not close-ended. Like, I feel like some people have this tendency to respond. Like, if I say, so, you know, where did you study? And they say, I don't know, give me a college name, RV. Yeah. And they just say RV. And they don't say RV, full stop, what about you? Or RV, but I hated it. Or RV, but it was the best time of my life.
Got it.
So you just respond with like a one word thing, then like, I don't know where to go from there.
So there are also some people who hate the whole, I did this, what about you? I did this, what about you? Like, there's this whole like, you know, whatever you ask them, they'll be like, huh, and you? Like, they won't come up with anything. Is that also like a bit of a turn off?
Yeah, you can like sort of share something about yourself without necessarily saying what about you. Like, you could just say, you know, well, I loved college, you know, but I have friends who didn't. So which kind of gives the other person the opportunity to say, oh, I'm like your friends or I'm like you.
Got it.
So you can sort of hint at it and like take the conversation forward without necessarily asking what about you every time.
Got it. Okay. I mean, suppose you're having a good time and you're having a conversation. Like, how does it get to a date? Like, what is an interesting date proposition for you to say, hey, yes, actually, I want to meet this person?
If we've chatted for several days and they have not annoyed me.
What is several days? How many days is like several days?
Like a week, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
I know there are some women who drag it on for like a month.
I met my husband like 2 years after I first chatted like with him, so
Yeah, so I, yeah, if you've been interesting for 7 days without being annoying, then we can meet. I mean, this isn't a pre/post-pandemic world.
Right,
now
Yeah.
I will spray you with sanitizer.
Got it. Okay. So now, like, okay, more or less, like, you know, we've sort of merged to a point where you're on a date. What's an interesting date? Like, does the location matter? Like, do you have to decide jointly? Do they have to propose where to meet? Like, what kind of a date is interesting? Like, just in terms of logistics of the date, like, is there something that stands out for you?
I'm a very picky eater. So I'm not a picky eater in the sense that I don't eat certain things, but I like certain places. So I will be the first to propose where to meet. And I would preferably like to meet where I want to go somewhere that I've been before, where I know the layout. Again, this is like a, you know, if you need to escape a predator kind of mentality. But I need to know it has to be somewhere crowded. Because some dates are really creepy, man. And you need to get the hell out of there, you know?
Oh, really?
Yeah, like, God, there so have old. Been times when I'm like on this date and I'm like, I just want to leave. And so if I'm in a place where I didn't have an immediate exit strategy, I will start getting stressed. So I needed to be a place where I need people around. I need to make sure that, like, I know where I am and I can leave at any time, and that kind of thing. So I'm very strategic about where I meet. If I am to go somewhere afterwards, then you meet me where I want to go. And if the conversation goes well, then we can move to the other place.
Got it.
But if this person is
that's
like,
interesting.
You know, come to Hebbal to unmark building number 23. It's actually a cafe. I'm like, no. You come to empty one. Because some people are great on paper and are great over the phone. But then you meet them and they're just kind of sleazy and very like, yeah, so, you know, you want to just get the bill and like head back to my place. Like, you're not that hot also. Please relax. So, yeah, there have definitely been times that I'm like, I need an out.
Got it. And is there like a particular like thing that you'd like to meet for, like coffee, drink, dinner? Like, I feel like all these meals are too long, right? Like, what if it's a terrible date? Like, what if you just want to get out of there? Like, isn't it too dicey to meet for dinner or something?
Never dinner, dude. It's always coffee or like some sort of evening situation. Also, I like to make sure I have a concrete plan afterwards.
Okay.
So if the date is going excellently, I would still like to bounce.
Okay.
Just to sort of be like, this is the end of this first date. I'm going home now. Which works well in multiple ways. One is that you sort of like clearly define that like I have a life and I'm not going to like do everything to be with you. Right. Especially on a first date. Secondly, if it is sucking, then you can be like, oh, this person just called. I need to go and prep for the thing. Bye.
Right.
So that's one. There are so many creepy people in the world. Like, I will also, like, if it's getting really bad, I have had friends. I have, like, if he's gone to the loo, I have messaged friends and said, call me, like, 3 times in a row. And then I will pick up and be like, okay, I need to go. Sorry. Like, I've had this happen, like, where this person was just being so forward. And I was like, can we just back the fuck up? So he went to the loo and I immediately texted my friend. I was like, call me 4 times in a row. And so he called and I continued to look like the... I'm enjoying, but like, I'm not going to be impolite. And then when the friend called for the third time, I'm like, okay, listen, I really need to take this.
Yeah.
So I have full strategies.
But what's a good date? Like, what results in a second date where you like leave feeling, wow, that was nice?
They were not too forward, as I mentioned.
Okay.
Not immediately like, what are your plans after this?
Yeah.
They came on time, which I really appreciate. They were just polite, like they didn't really argue with me about splitting the bill. Like, I really like to split the bill on the first date, first couple of dates for the rest of my life.
What if they didn't argue but then they let you pay?
That's fine.
Okay.
Because like, I will only offer the bill. Okay. I will only offer to split the bill. I'm never going to offer to pay the whole thing.
Got it. Yeah.
You won't pay the whole thing. I won't pay the whole thing. We'll split it. But if you get all like knight in shining armor, chivalry, whatever, I'll be like, I'm a grown ass adult. I'm not a 5-year-old you brought out for milkshakes. So please, just like treat me like an adult, you know?
Right.
That's one. And then the fact that they were like, just sort of not distracted, not like on their phone, not like sort of spaced out, they're paying attention to what they're saying, they're responding with interesting things. And dude, the one thing that I cannot handle on a first date is like whining. Like there are some people who will just complain for the entire first date, like, oh, my life sucks and this sucks and my job sucks. And like, if that's your whole personality, like, you can take a negativity somewhere else. Because I'm out.
Got it.
Because first of all, you're talking about yourself. Secondly, you're complaining about everything.
Right.
So I'm not going to be some magic wand to come in and fix your life. If you're so unhappy with your life and you've done nothing to change it, I'm not going to come in and, you know, add to this list of misery that you have going
on. That's interesting. So if there are a list of things that they can talk about, like what's allowed, that's like neutral, like interesting territory, what would that be?
For me, it's a mix between sort of like generic conversation and like GK. Personal.
Okay.
Huh? GK. Dude, one boy started talking to me about electrons and how like electrons become aware when you're looking at them. And that's like a thing in quantum physics. And I was like, yeah, I've read that. And like we had this whole conversation about quantum physics. And I was like, yes. Like I was all about that. But like sometimes I feel like if the person is only talking about other stuff and not talking about themselves at all, then that's also kind of like, okay, but what about you? Like we can't just talk about you the entire time.
Yeah.
Like I also want to know about you as a person, right?
Got it.
And also talk about the ex on the first date.
Yeah. Correct. Yeah. And how about people who slide in like they try to pass this off as a joke, but then you're like, oh my God, like that's too forward and creepy, where they say, okay, if we do end up together, this is what we're going to name our kids, kind of like, and they like joke about it because they want to try and see if you want to meet them again. Not.
I'm out. I am like, go to and I'll disappear. But the thing is like, there's a huge difference between finding out if you want to meet again and asking about kids.
Right.
If we're genuinely talking about kids, like, let's say there's a kid at the table next to us and the kid is just like, nye, 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 nye. And this person's like, huh, I don't know how I'll do as a dad. Then that's fine. That's okay. But if you're just going to, like, out of nowhere, be like, so, 2 kids or 3? I'll be like, bye. because I've been on some dates where the guy's been like, it's been January or something, and this guy is like, yeah, I'm going to Hong Kong with my friends in November. Do you want to come? Or should I delete Bumble now that we've met? And I'm like, we met 25 minutes ago. The masala peanuts has not even reached the table. Kindly one step at a time. Like, I'm flattered that you think you can delete the app now that you've met me, but
yeah,
relax. You know?
So you've gone on a date, you want to go on another date with them, like from there on, like from the second date on, what results in exclusivity? Like, where do you actually say, okay, you know, I could see myself like hanging out just with this dude? Like, what are the qualities? What are standout qualities about a guy like this? You'll be like, yeah, I know I'm looking for someone like that right now, but then based on past experiences and generally.
So I personally have a tendency to rush into things.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, if the person is good, like has not pissed me off particularly in 3 days, I'm like, yeh hai success, yaar. So I kind of like, I jump into things before I should. Right. But my latest test is just time. Right. If you don't piss me off, we will have arguments, we will disagree, whatever, but I also want to see how you are at conflict resolution, right? So this is a tip that I got from a friend actually, which is that 100 days will tell you clearly what a person is like. And my shrink said the same thing, that 90 days, like 3 months, will tell you very clearly about a person, because 90 days is enough time for you to have talked, for you to have disagreed, for them to have had something that in their life that you could support them with, vice versa, whatever it might be.
Sure.
So 3 months to 100 days is like the perfect amount of time. So now, I mean, I haven't met anybody that I've put through the 100-day test since I've settled on this number. But that's what I would like to do. Like, I would not, I don't think I would get exclusive with somebody those 100 days.
God. Would you say that's like a general rule that like your friends also sort of follow? Because I feel like this is a question that a lot of people ask me. They're like, how many times do I have to meet this person? How long do I have to talk to this person before I stop talking to other people? Like,
I think it's also okay for like not everybody to be up to this 100 day thing. Like, if the other person is like very sure and they decide to stop seeing other people, that's fine with me, but like I am not gonna commit. Like, but we can have that conversation. We can talk about like, hey, I really don't want to see anybody else, like what about you? And then I could say, well, I need more time and I'd like to, you know, take things slow. So I don't mind having that check-in conversation sooner without necessarily committing. So if both of you are like not on the same page in terms of when that exclusivity comes, that's still okay, as long as you're talking about it and saying, it's not that like I'm dating other people. It's just that I don't want this to be like boyfriend, girlfriend until a certain amount of time.
Got it. Got it. Interesting. Is there like a bunch of things that you like to find out about the other person before you say, okay, I'm not going to die if I get into a relationship with this person?
I think how they view like some very high level things, which are super important to me. Like if they're homophobic, transphobic, racist, Islamophobic, whatever it might be, like if they have these broad categories of like any kind of bias against a large population, which is obviously stereotyping, I'm like, bye. I did somebody once who was like, all Pakistanis. And I was like, what the hell? Pakistani friends. Then it's not all of them. How can you say that?
So I was actually going to ask you that follow-up question, like with another example. I met somebody who said, oh my God, I met this guy and his take on that movie Kabir Singh was really like, you know, screwed up. And like, I never wanted to see this person again. But like, you will have ideological differences with your friends as well. But like today we're moving in a world where we're increasingly distancing ourselves from people who have views that are like contrary to ours, right? Like, but what are you going to do when you are in a committed relationship with somebody and they have like different ideologies from you about different things, right? Like, why is this aspect so important? And you're not the only one saying it. Like, a lot of women say this, right? Like, I don't want someone who's racist. I don't want someone who's sexist and things like that. Why has that become so important today?
See, for me, that's like a fundamental value thing, right? Like, this goes back to religion. Like religion also, like people used to self-select within religions because that means that you align on certain values,
right?
You align on, you know, this kind of prayer, this kind of, you know, dietary preference, you align on this kind of whatever. Now, because we are becoming less tied to those religious things, it comes down to your personal values.
Sure.
So if you know, I mean, I'm not really going to be stressed if the other person is vegan and they don't expect me to be vegan, that's fine.
Right.
Like, that's okay. But if I'm going to introduce you to a black friend and you're going to be like, I don't want to shake his hand, or be like, oh, and you like sit at that table with my black friend and say like, oh, your parents are still together. Oh, you finished college. Then I will literally stop a cigarette on your face and leave. So that's like, because I have friends of different ethnicities. I have friends who are gay. I have friends who don't necessarily speak fluent English. So if you're going to be judgmental about any of these things, you're not going to get the kind of people that I'm friends with, the kind of people that I hang out with. If we're going to merge lives and your friends come to a party, my friends come to a party, and your racist friends are like, I don't want to talk to anyone who's not Indian, then that's not going to work at all.
But what about because they have had no exposure. Like, for example, you've lived abroad and, you know, you've had a lot of exposure, maybe even back home, like before you moved abroad, like, you know, you came from a liberal setting and you had that exposure. What about somebody who's not had that exposure, but is sort of malleable to change given that sort of exposure? Like, is that new value potential?
Yeah, like as long as you're willing to admit something, like if you see, because like racism is like a deep-seated dislike or hatred, right? Sure. Like same as homophobia. If you just say like, oh, I've never met a black person or I've never met a gay person, that's fine. Then you don't get to have an opinion.
Sure.
Because you've never met this person, like you don't know how you feel about it. That's fine. You've never had this experience. It's okay. Like I don't expect everyone to have been skydiving or whatever.
Right.
Right? But as long as you're willing to admit that you don't know. Like,
got it.
And like, even with ideological arguments, right? Like, let's say someone says something Islamophobic, and I'm like, you can't label everybody like that. And they're like, oh, but why not? Pakistan is the enemy. And then we like have this whole conversation where we then sort of break down the difference between Islamophobia and political issues and history and whatever. And you're able to say, like, okay, fine, you know, I don't like that Pakistan, the nation, is attacking India, the nation. But I don't have a problem with individual people who happen to be born in Pakistan. That's okay. And like, it's the same thing for me, right? Like, if I say something classist or, you know, whatever, homophobic or sexist or whatever, and someone calls me out and says, I have made ableist comments before, like, without really intending to. And my friend called me out and she was like, that's not okay. And I was like, yeah, actually, damn, that's not okay. Like, I shouldn't say that again.
Yeah,
and so you just admit it and you learn from it and you grow, like that's okay.
Got it. And where does it stand in terms of the list of priorities, right? Like okay, you know, just for example, you're somebody who's moody, like there's somebody who can put up with your moodiness like magic, but they don't have a lot of exposure in terms of like gender equality or like, you know, equality among all humans and stuff like that. Like where does it stand in the list of your priorities? I feel like a lot of times people who have this sort of hatred or phobia or whatever are people who actually haven't had enough exposure. And it's not so much the quantity, but it's just the quality of exposure for them to build that empathy, right? So I feel like that is something that can change a lot more than someone's inherent character, like if you know what I mean.
I feel like it's the other way. Like you can learn to develop certain skills and like in terms of like time management and how you dress and how you like all of those. I feel like individual personality is more malleable than at least for me, because I've been through a very long journey with therapy and all of that. So for me, that is, see, again, if you've not had exposure to a certain group of people and you have hatred against them, I'm out. If you're indifferent to them and you admit that you don't know enough, that's still okay. If you're like, if you want to make an assumption about somebody and hate them for it, and you're over 25 years old, bye.
Got it.
Like, okay, go live your life, have your exposure, learn your shit, and come back, because I am already 50 steps ahead of where you are right now. I'm not going to be here like trying to teach you how the world works.
That's interesting. The reason why I asked this is, although these are not the sort of things that like that comes up in terms of exposure, the one theme that I've seen a lot with men that comes up is them not having had exposure to women, or like them not having been in past relationships because of which they don't know enough about women. And that sometimes gets held against men, where women say, oh, you've never been in a relationship, I don't think this is going to work. Right? They don't know what they don't know. But like, how do you sort of see potential in people saying, okay, this guy doesn't know, but like he might change?
See, again, for me, I feel like I've passed that stage. Okay. Like I'm almost 30. Like if you haven't dated anybody and you're 30, that is a deal breaker for me. Like if you're talking about marriage, because I'm literally not here to teach you the basics. I would say if you're 30 and you've never been in a relationship, go fuck around, dude. Download Tinder, go fuck around, go on some casual dates, have a whole phase, like do whatever you want to do, figure your life out. And then when you want you have to be of a certain emotional maturity level, dude.
So what if nobody wants to date them because they've never like dated? Like even if on Tinder, they're like, how will they get that first person? Who's going to give them that first shot?
Find one 22-year-old. No, who doesn't give a shit. Basically, what I'm saying is find someone who's at the same level as you are. Because that person exists. There might be a 30-year-old woman who's never been in a relationship. You'll figure it out together from scratch. It has nothing to do with age. It has to do with your experience. If you're, in terms of relationship experience, I have 10 years and you have 0 years, find someone else who has 0 years and you'll figure it out.
That's actually interesting. So I feel like the kind of men like who don't have experience, but they're like, you know, they're willing to sort of learn, want cooler women, and they're not willing to give a shot to a woman who is like not as cool enough, if you know what I mean. Like, is there, like, do you have any like sort of gyan to give to such men? And I feel like I meet so many of such men.
I will be your mentor to help you date other women, but you're not dating. You find your cool women, find cool women who can help you meet other women who are at the same level as you. Because I have friends who are like 20, 21, 22, who are like just now like, so there's this girl, like, what's your advice? And like, I sit and talk to them and I'm like, you know, you can do this. And then they'll call me and be like, she said this, should I call her? Should I not call her? Whatever. I'm totally open to being your like big sister, buddy, whatever it might be. I will help you.
Rafi sister.
Yeah, like just you go date someone else. I will be the, your cool friend who will help you date someone else. But Chinna, you're not dating me.
But the issue that I've seen with that is they're in the arranged marriage market and they find that they, like in their head, they're cool and they want cool women. But because they come from conservative families, they've never really had the opportunity to sort of date or like be reckless in their life. And so right now, like they're finding out too late in life that they should have actually gone out and dated.
See, I think at a certain point, you need to remain in your awkward, okay? Like, right. I don't mean that in a bad way, okay?
Right.
Like, I once met this person who was incredible to talk to, okay? Very knowledgeable about the world, very politically aware, like, you know, can talk to you about the history of Leninism in Eastern China and all. And I'm like, I'm not at the same level as this.
Right.
I aspire to be there. I think this person is incredible. I would love nothing more than to have their attention.
Yeah.
But like, hello, reality check.
Right.
This person is like a potential future Man Booker Prize winner.
Right.
And you are not. So let them go find a fellow potential Man Booker Prize winner.
Right.
And just realize what's realistic for yourself. Because of course, man, I want to date Vicky Kaushal. But his lifestyle and my lifestyle are completely different. So I'm not going to be able to like walk into his life and suddenly be accosted by the paparazzi and just, you know, roll with it.
Got
but it would make more sense for him to date whatever who Katrina
gets. So almost like saying let the market decide who you get to sort of see. Like, you know, if you get rejected by a woman, like, you know, take the cue and like go find your type. Okay.
Yeah.
That's definitely very useful. And I feel like a lot of people just don't know how to take the cue, which is why like they hang around being single for a long time, hoping that something will change, right?
I think people need to realize that you need to remember who you are. If you were the opposite sex version of yourself, would you date you? If you would not, then either fix yourself or find someone who's at your level. Because if you want to wear rubber chappals and grow out your beard and take a shower once a month and you expect your wife to be, you know, whatever, Miss Universe, first runner-up, it's not going to happen. I want to date Chris Evans. Chris Evans doesn't want to date me. That's the reality. I have to accept.